Tanto Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ashes of Roses by MJ Auch, narrated by Ruth Urquhart. 1.
There was no sense trying to sleep. This was the last night we'd be tossed by the waves in our narrow bunks. We were due to pull into New York Harbor at dawn, putting an end to the most unbearable 2 weeks of my life. I shifted in my cot, trying to nudge my little sister Bridget over. She was barely 4, and small for her age, but she took up more than her share of the narrow shelf we were supposed to call a bed. Mads staked out a claim to 4 bunks in a row on the lower level when we first boarded the ship, but Bridget whimpered that she was lonely and moved into my bunk the first night. Next to us was Maureen, the middle sister, who made it clear from the beginning that she wasn't sharing a bunk with anyone. I don't remember being that stubborn at 12. I heard poor little Joseph begin to whimper. He slept with Ma, although for the amount of sleeping he did, he might as well have kept his eyes wide open. The last few days especially, he was fussing more time than he was quiet. I'd be glad to get off the ship so I wouldn't have to endure the comments of our fellow passengers who were getting less patient with Joseph by the day. I loved my baby brother, but I wasn't so anxious to be around him myself. I nudged Bridget over again, but the motion of the boat sent her rolling right back to me. Finally, I gave up and fished for my shoes and shawl under my bunk. I decided to go up on the deck and see if any land was in sight. I tucked Bridget in with Maureen and climbed the ladder to the deck. A soft grey light filled the sky and the wind made me pull my coat tighter around me. I wish we could have made this trip in the summer instead of February. We'd seen so little of sunshine, I'd almost forgotten what it looked like. It had been 2 weeks ago that we set sail from Cork. As long as I could remember, Dad talked about coming to America for a better life. So many people had left before us, it seemed the natural thing to do. As we pulled out of port, one man had shouted, "Will the last man out of Ireland please lock the door?" That brought a round of laughter from his friends, but we weren't more than an hour at sea before they were gulping pints of ale and singing about wanting to go back to dear old Ireland. Grandma Nolan had told Dad that no matter how much you wanted to leave, Ireland would tug on your heart until you returned. I thought she was just saying that to make him stay with her in Limerick, but maybe there was something to it. The deck was empty this last morning, except for an old man who always seemed to be there, as if watching for land would bring it on sooner. He was leaning on the rail, squinting into the wind. "See that?" he asked. I looked around to make sure he was talking to me. "See what?" I said.
"That dark shape over there, and another to the left of it. That's the Narrows. When we go through there, we'll be in New York Harbour."
"You mean it's land?" I asked. "I can't see anything at all." As we moved closer, I could gradually make out what the man was talking about. There were other ships too, but I couldn't tell if they were coming or going. Other passengers were starting to appear on deck now. My heart beat fast as I crashed down the ladder to the steerage quarters.
"Ma! Maureen! Get up! We can see New York! Come up on the deck!"
Ma sat up and went into action.
"Help me get shoes on the girls, Margaret Rose, and make sure all our things are packed into the 2 suitcases. Your father has the trunk over in the men's quarters."
"But can't all this wait, Ma? I just want to see the city. I'll come right back to help you."
All the talking had wakened the other passengers. As they climbed out of their bunks, every inch of floor space filled with bodies. The first and second class passengers had their own compartments, but in steerage we were crammed like fish in a tin. Maureen sat up and rubbed her eyes.
"Where are we? Is this America?"
She pulled on her shoes and headed for the ladder with laces flopping.
"Stay right here," Ma said. "We need to gather our things. Maureen, take the large suitcase and I'll carry the small one along with lugging Joseph. Margaret Rose, you carry the feather bed and hang on to Bridget. There's going to be a great crush of people getting off this boat."
"But we're going to miss the Statue of Liberty," I protested. "I could have stayed on the deck, but I wanted you all to see it."
"And see it we will," Ma said. "But we're not going up on the deck till I say we're ready. Now, run a comb through your hair, and your sister's too. I'll not have Uncle Patrick see you looking like a bunch of ragamuffins."
Maureen and I were ready to jump out of our skins by the time Ma decided we were ready. We waited our turn in line. Maureen went up first, then Ma handed the large suitcase to her.
It was my turn next. I was glad to be going up this ladder for the last time. All through the voyage, the boys would make a big fuss about looking up the girls' skirts as we climbed. They must have been pretty bored to get so worked up over a glimpse of bloomers. Ma had the feather bed tied firmly in a tablecloth, but it was still bulky. I had struggled about halfway up the ladder when the ship began to tilt. I clung to the rung above me, but there was a ruckus behind Ma.
"Saints preserve us, we're sinking!"
a red-faced man shouted. He grabbed my shoulder and pulled me down from the ladder, then pushed ahead and climbed out to save himself. People were shoving behind us.
"Go ahead, Margaret Rose," Ma said. "I'll be pushing Bridget right up after ye."
"Are we sinking?" Bridget whined.
Ma gave her a boost.
"I don't know, but I'd rather find out on the top deck than down here."
I turned to grab Bridget's hand. It was easy to keep track of Ma because Joseph was howling like a banshee. We skidded down the narrow hallway, packed in shoulder to shoulder with the other steerage passengers. The wall was tilting at a crazy angle, making it hard to sense which way was up. Were we really going to sink? Had we travelled all the way across the ocean, only to be dumped like bilge into the harbour of New York?
"Stay together!"
Ma shouted. I could hear Maureen ahead of me, with the big suitcase sounding like a gong as it kept bumping the metal walls. If we had to jump overboard, I hoped she'd be sensible enough to leave it. Lord knows there was little of any value in our belongings. Certainly nothing worth being anchored to the bottom of the harbour for. There was a throng pushing and shoving at the last stairwell.
"Margaret Rose, I'm frightened," Bridget wailed.
I gathered her up in my arms, then shifted her to one hip so I could grab the iron railing to keep my balance. When we finally came up out of steerage into the fresh air, I could hear the captain shouting over a bullhorn.
"All passengers, please move to the centre of the boat."
There was no doubt that the deck was tilted, but I couldn't see that we were taking on any water. The lifeboats hung in their places. The crew had made no move to load them. All of the passengers crowded together on the low side of the deck. That's when I realised what the problem had been. We were just passing the Statue of Liberty and everyone had rushed to that side of the boat to see her. The captain pleaded with the crowd again.
"Ladies, gentlemen, please move away from the rail to the centre."
But nobody moved a muscle. Ignoring Ma's order to stay together, I put Bridget down, held tight to her hand and pushed through the crowd. I finally squeezed into a spot by the rail and brought her around in front of me where she could see through the iron mesh. I was afraid to lift her above the rail for fear I'd drop her overboard in my excitement. There stood Lady Liberty, more beautiful than ever she'd appeared in the black and white pictures I'd seen. She was a lovely soft green in colour, and the rosy sun gave a blush to her cheeks. I couldn't believe how big she was. She towered over the harbour like a giantess who had waded in from the ocean. The ship grew strangely silent. I saw tears in the eyes of the man next to me. It was February the 18th, 1911, the date that would mark the start of my new life. My heart swelled with hope and fear at the same time. I had the feeling that I was brought to America for a purpose. Something important would happen to me here. I remember the words of the poem, "Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses." Well, we were poor all right, and after 2 weeks crammed into the bottom of a boat with Joseph screaming his fool head off, we certainly qualified as tired, huddled masses. "Here we are, America," I whispered. "We're just exactly what you ordered."
2.
Once we passed the Statue of Liberty, I tried to look for Da and Ma, but they were lost in a sea of hats. Poor Bridget was crying because she only came up to the belt buckles of most of the men. I was afraid she'd be trampled, so I lifted her on my hip, even though it made it harder to push through the people with the cumbersome feather bed. It was Da who found us, just as the ship was slipping into the pier. He took Bridget in his strong arms so she could see over the crowd. There was an announcement.
"More first and second class passengers go to B deck for inspection, then disembark here. Steerage passengers will disembark and immediately board the ferry to Ellis Island."
"Are we first class, Da?"
Bridget asked. Da shook his head.
"No, we go to Ellis Island."
"But ye always call us your first class beauties,"
Bridget insisted. Da kissed her cheek.
"That ye are, lass. But the steamship company counts only the price of your ticket.
Someday, when we go back to visit Ireland, we'll travel first class, after we've made our fortune in America.
I kept that in mind as we watched the fancy folks get off at the pier. We were herded like cattle onto the ferry boat, our feet touching America only for the time it took to walk from the ship's gangplank to the one leading to the ferry. Then it was off into the harbour again, this time heading for a destination we feared. We had heard many tales of Ellis Island, the place where the immigration officials decided whether or not you were fit to enter America's gates. A person could be turned away for all sorts of things, especially sickness. I was thankful for the fact that we were healthy. Da always said, "We may be poor, but we have our health." Good health would be worth more than gold on Ellis Island. I looked around at some of the other immigrants. One woman, pale as a ghost, held a sickly baby who seemed to struggle for each breath. I felt sorry for them. Surely they wouldn't make it past the medical inspection. There was a young man with a racking cough who didn't seem destined to become an American either. I edged away from them. I wouldn't want to catch something now that might keep me from getting into America. Soon we could see Ellis Island up ahead. It looked like a confection, with its four domed turrets and dozens of arched windows edged with cream-coloured bricks. It was hard to imagine that this pretty place could hold such terrible disappointment for some of the people on board with us. We had a long time to worry about Ellis Island. There were two ferry boats steaming ahead of us, and they landed first. We had to wait until all of their passengers were unloaded. It was 2 hours before we could set foot on land again. I spent the whole time avoiding people who looked like they might be sick. There was no heat on the ferry, and a cold February wind blew across the water. By the time they let us off, my throat was already feeling sore. Finally, it was our turn.
"Step lively, children," Da said. "Margaret Rose, mind you keep a tight hold on Bridget. I don't want anyone getting lost."
The thought of losing a family gave me a chill. I'd never seen so many people at once. I gripped Bridget's hand so tight she let out a yelp. Da took the feather bed to carry along with the trunk, so I grabbed the hem of his jacket with my other hand. I knew he wouldn't let anything happen to us. We were given numbered tags and split into long lines. They separated the men from the women, then the women with small children. Joseph and Bridget went with Ma. "How will we find each other again?" I asked, not wanting to let go of Da.
"Just don't be losing your tag, whatever you do," Da said.
Maureen and I clung to each other as we moved forward in line. "I'm scared," she whispered. "Don't be a ninny," I said, trying to look brave, hoping my trembling lower lip didn't give me away. "There are so many people. There'll be even more when we get into New York, so get used to it." When we neared the front of the line, an official-looking woman in a uniform came up to me.
"Take down the top of your dress so the doctor can never listen to your chest."
"But I've nothing underneath," Maureen whispered. I was glad I wore a chemise under mine. I slipped out of my coat and dress top and held them around me until it was my turn. The woman doctor was thin-lipped and stern.
"Take a deep breath."
The listening contraption was still warm from the last person. I tried to breathe as quietly as possible. What could she hear? Was there some little sound in my chest that could give me away as unhealthy and send me back to Ireland?
"A deep breath," she repeated.
This time I obeyed. She listened, nodded, and waved me on ahead. I was poked and prodded by several more women, then allowed to button up my dress. I thought the worst was over until I went into the last line. A man in a uniform told me to hold still. Then he pulled up my eyelid with a button hook. It happened so quickly I didn't have time to cry out. But the second eye was worse because I knew what to expect. I jerked my head back when I saw the hook coming.
"You're just making this harder on yourself, girl," the examiner said. "And you're holding up the line."
"I'm sorry," I mumbled. I folded my arms tight around myself and tilted my head back obediently. He got a good grip on my lower lashes so I couldn't pull away. The hook hurt even more this time. When it was over, I emerged half stunned into the huge registry room. "We have to find Ma and Da," I said, but Maureen wasn't there. Then I saw that she had moved several people behind in the line for the button hook examination. I shivered and turned away. That's when I saw Da sitting on a bench. I ran to him. "Dad, they just did the most terrible thing to me." Da nodded.
The eye exam. 'Twas nasty, wasn't it? Patrick told me about it in a letter.
You knew and you didn't tell us.
Ah, so you'd rather have worried about that exam coming all the way across the ocean?
No, I guess not.
I rubbed my eyes where I could still feel the button hook.
But why do they do that?
Da shrugged. It's some disease they test for.
But why don't they just tell you to keep your eyes open so they can look? I would have gladly done that. There was no need for the hook.
Stop dwelling on it, Margaret Rose. Just thank the good Lord you passed. There's where you'll be going.
He pointed to a huge half-circle window that reached all the way to a two-story ceiling. At first, I thought it was a picture in a frame, but then I realised I was looking for the first time at the great city of New York.
Your husband is waiting for you in that city,
Da said, grinning. I felt my face go red. I'm a long way for looking for a husband, Da.
Don't be so sure, Margaret Rose. There are more good Irish lads in the city of New York than in Dublin and Limerick put together.
I wasn't about to argue with Da, but I had no plans to marry at 16. A whole new world was stretching out before me, and I wanted a chance to savour it before I was weighed down with babies like Ma. She had had me when she was only 17. If we had stayed in Ireland, that would have been my fate. But I hoped there was something else for me in America, something more than being a wife and mother right away. I looked up to see Ma coming towards us with Bridget clinging to her skirt and Joseph in her arms. He was thrashing his head about and screaming bloody murder. A man in uniform was with them. Da stood up.
What's wrong? You'll have to come with me, sir. I'm taking you to another room where you can make arrangements. Arrangements? Arrangements for what?
I couldn't help but notice the way the Americans talked. They spoke the English language, but it was hard to understand, and even harder on the ears. The man's R's sounded like a dog's growl instead of Da's, which were soft like a purring cat. The man led us into a side room. There were other families there, all looking as confused as we were.
Sit here and wait.
We all sat without protest, but as soon as the man left, Da gripped Ma's arm.
What the devil's going on?
Ma's eyes were huge with fright.
It's Joseph. They won't let the poor babe into the country.
That's nonsense, Da said. Why would they keep out a baby? What harm could he do to anyone?
Ma cuddled Joseph to her shoulder and stroked his head, but he was having none of it.
It's his eyes. They're saying he has some sort of infection. They told me the name. Nobody with this disease is allowed in the country.
He's never had any trouble with his eyes. Let me see him.
Da reached over and took Joseph into his lap.
What's Joseph got writ on him?
Bridget asked.
Read me what it says.
Someone had chalked the letters EC on his little wool jacket. It's not a word, I whispered in her ear. It's just letters. I noticed several other people in the room with the same chalk marks on their clothes. They all looked perfectly normal to me. Bridget's voice got higher.
What's happened to Joseph's eyes? They're all squinty.
She's right, I said. He wasn't like that before. What did they do to him? Ma's hand trembled as she reached over and smoothed back Joseph's hair.
It's the drops. They pried his eyes wide open and squeezed something in from the bottle. Must have stung like the very devil.
I'll see about this.
Da handed Joseph back to Ma.
There wasn't a thing wrong with the boy's eyes till they messed with him. Try to blind the poor babe, they did.
He started out of the room.
Michael, please don't go. They told us to stay here and wait.
Da didn't listen to her. I followed him as far as the door and watched as he marched directly to the head of the eye examination line. The examiner pointed to the end of the line. They argued for a few minutes, with Da waving his arms, gesturing towards us. I didn't need to hear the words to know that Da wasn't winning the argument. Then he went over to the next examiner, and the hand waving started anew. I leaned out of the doorway so I could see him talking to three more people at desks, getting more agitated with each one. Finally, a man took him by the elbow and brought him over to our room. I ducked back to the bench so Da wouldn't know I'd been spying on him.
What did they say, Michael?
Ma asked. Is it all settled then? Da didn't have to answer. From the look on his face, I knew that little Joseph Nolan was not about to become an American. And if he couldn't, we had a gnawing fear that none of us could.
3.
It's no use, Da said. They say anybody who's got the trachoma doesn't get into America. That's the law.
Is it catching? I edged away from Joseph, thinking of the many times I had held him. He seemed fine before. Of course, he'd been bawling his way clear across the ocean, but that was just Joseph. Da rubbed his forehead.
The man said most people come in here not knowing they have it.
Can they make him better? I asked. Can we... Da didn't let me finish.
Stop with your questions, girl. How is a man to think?
I watched as the people who were behind us in line moved ahead to the next holding pen. I could hear a ferry blast its horn.
So, we all return now? Ma asked. After everything it took to get here, now they ship all of us back.
Da shook his head.
Not all of us. Joseph's the only one. The rest of us checked out fine.
Ma pulled Joseph close to her.
Have you lost your mind, Michael? I'm not giving up my baby. If Joseph goes back, we all go back.
Da's head snapped up.
And use what to pay for the passage?
Ma clutched at Da's sleeve.
But we had some money left after we paid for the tickets.
Not enough.
Surely there's a less expensive ship, one we could all afford to take.
Good Lord, Margaret, if we had any cheaper quarters, it'd be dragging us across the sea at the end of a tow rope.
Ma was sobbing now, her face buried in Joseph's shoulder. I patted her back, making sure not to get too close to Joseph. Then I saw Maureen standing in the registry room, looking around with a panicked expression on her face. In all the fuss about Joseph, we'd forgotten her. I ran out to get her. Maureen looked relieved when she saw me.
Where did everybody go?
I pointed to her family sitting in the side room.
Why is Joseph taking on so?
They put something in his eyes. He's got the trachoma.
What's that?
Maureen looked past me.
What's got Ma so upset?
Whatever it is, it's bad enough to keep Joseph out of America. He has to go back. Maureen just stared at me for a few seconds, then her eyes narrowed. I knew that look. Maureen's temper was worse than Da's.
Oh, no, they don't. Nobody can make me go back. I passed the examination. I'm going to be an American and that's all there is to it.
Don't get so worked up. Joseph's the only one they're holding back. Da says there's not enough money to send us all back to Ireland.
Well, a baby can't cross the ocean by himself. Did you think of that? Somebody will have to go with him.
Maureen was right. Da had to be here to support us with his wages, and Ma would need to care for Bridget and bring in some extra money with her sewing. Maureen was too young to care for Joseph all the way back over the ocean, so there was only one logical person, me. But they couldn't make me do it. I'd dive off Ellis Island and swim for New York before I'd get on a boat bound for Ireland. We had nothing back in Ireland but cranky old Grandma Nolan, and there wasn't a boy in Limerick I'd want for a husband. I ran back up to the family just in time to hear the plan Da had come up with.
I'll take the boy back to my mother, he said. She'll be happy to care for him.
Da was going. I didn't have to go back. And Grandma Nolan would be happy to get Joseph. Not likely. As far as I'd seen, she was never happy about anything.
I'll have to work a while to get the money to book my passage back to America,
Da continued.
If the boy's eyes are clear by then, I'll bring him. If not, he can stay with my mother. Lord knows she's raised enough Nolan boys to make a good job of it.
Joseph is not one of your mother's Nolan boys,
Ma sobbed.
He's my son, not hers.
But Da wasn't listening. He was busy counting out the money he had. I once heard Grandma Nolan say that children should be raised like cabbages. They'd do just fine if you kept pulling out the weeds. Poor Joseph was spoiled being the youngest and headstrong. Grandma would have a good deal of weed pulling to do on him, I suspected. There was another blast from the ferry whistle. An old woman sat on the bench across from us with her belongings, crying as her family kissed her goodbye and left her. There was an H chalked on her coat. Did that stand for a broken heart? What kind of country would break up families this way? Ma was near hysterical now.
I can't abandon my baby. He's barely weaned.
He's weaned almost 6 months now, Margaret.
Da jutted out his chin, but his eyes had the shimmer of tears in them.
I've reasoned this out, and there's no other way. Think of your daughters. There's no life for them in Ireland.
They'll marry and have children, Ma said. It was good enough for me.
But not for me, I whispered, not quite brave enough to say the words for all to hear. Ma rose from the bench.
What about your dreams for your only son in America? You're giving up on him.
Joseph will come to America one day, but this isn't his time.
He stood up.
Now take the girls and get in line.
Ma clutched at Dad's lapels.
I don't know how to make my way here alone, Michael.
You'll not be alone. You'll be with my brother and his family. And Margaret Rose is almost full grown. She'll be a help to you.
He pushed some money and a folded piece of paper into her hand.
I'm leaving myself just enough money for the return trip. Give the rest to Patrick. Here's his address. I'll send you a letter as soon as I get there. And be sure to write and let me know how you're doing.
Da unstrapped the trunk, pulled out a few things for himself and Joseph, and packed them in the smaller suitcase. The examiner came into the room.
We'll have to separate you now. Who is going back with the child?
I'll be taking him,
Da said.
All right then, follow me.
Da kissed us each in turn.
Be strong, he whispered to me. Your ma needs you now.
Maybe ma should be the one to take Joseph, I whispered back. Da shook his head.
Leave it be, Margaret Rose. Your ma wasn't so keen on coming here in the first place. If she goes back...
He didn't finish the sentence. Da tried to pull the squalling Joseph from Ma's arms, but Joseph hung on like a burdock. The poor babe was tired and sick. All he wanted was his ma, and he couldn't stand to watch the struggle. I stepped behind Ma and pried Joseph's little fists away from the collar of her coat. As Da wrenched Joseph away, Ma followed him out into the registry room, but I caught her around her waist and held tight.
Don't take my baby! Ma wailed. Please, Michael! He needs me!
The examiner cleared his throat and looked away. He had a sad expression on his face, as if he'd watched this scene play out 100 times before.
Margaret Rose,
Da said, his voice hoarse.
Help your mother!
He had tears rolling down his cheeks. I knew he was asking for help for himself, not Ma.
Please, Ma, I said, pressing my cheek against hers. Nothing can be done. You're only making it worse for all of us.
I knew I was doing the right thing, but it felt as if I was breaking apart all the links that held our family together. I don't know if it was my words or my holding her back that got through to Ma. All of a sudden, she stopped struggling and sagged against me. Then her piercing scream echoed at me from all corners of the huge room, like arrows going through my body. The last thing I saw was Joseph reaching his little arms over Dad's shoulder, his eyes wide with the shock of betrayal. I hadn't even kissed my poor brother goodbye.
4.
We huddled together in the registry room, trying to comfort Ma, though she was near inconsolable. People walked around us as if we were just a pile of luggage. It seemed forever before Ma quieted down enough to be reasoned with. Joseph will be fine, I said. He'll probably be coming back with Dad in just a few weeks.
2 weeks each way for the passage, Ma said, sniffling. In between another month or two earning the fare. Babies forget. My own son won't know me when we meet again.
Ma pulled out her handkerchief and sobbed into it until a woman in uniform tapped her gently on the shoulder.
You must move on now. Follow me, please.
She took us across the registry room and pointed to a long bench surrounded by high railings and a chain fence.
Wait here until your name is called.
We settled ourselves and our goods and looked up to find ourselves facing a bench full of people on the other side of our pen. Behind them was another pen and another, stretching as far as we could see, all crammed with people. Maureen folded her arms and slid down in the seat.
We've done enough waiting. I want to see New York.
Hush. Ma said. We might miss hearing our name. So we sat in silence, jumping every time a person came by calling out names. They were speaking in all kinds of languages, reciting names unlike any I'd ever heard. It wasn't long before the words melted into each other, and I was afraid I wouldn't recognise our name even if I heard it loud and clear. The people around us looked foreign, not Irish for sure. Most had brown or black hair, dark skin and odd clothing. The women wore full printed skirts with shawls and kerchiefs. Even the tiniest of the girls were bundled up like little old ladies. Some of the men wore strange fur hats that looked like overturned flower pots. I tried to eavesdrop in their conversations, but the words made no sense. The only thing we all had in common was the fear on our faces. I stood up and looked around. Though there had been 2,000 of us on the boat from Ireland, I didn't see a familiar face now, or even the pale skin and blue eyes of an Irishman. In the time we'd lost with the business over Joseph, it seemed our whole ship had been passed through Ellis Island. My heart felt like a fist in my chest. Poor little Joseph. Would Dad be able to comfort him? I felt guiltily grateful that Mad stayed with us. Though Dar was the head of the family, it was Ma who could make me feel better when I was sick or frightened. I had the feeling I'd be needing that comfort in the coming weeks. As much as I wanted the adventure of coming to America, I could already feel myself longing for the familiar streets of Limerick and the sight of Tommen Bridge over the River Shannon. Ma jumped suddenly to her feet.
Nolan, that's us!
We hastily gathered up her goods and half-carried, half-dragged them over to the registration desk. Ma had to carry Bridget because she'd fallen asleep. We arrived at the desk at the same time as another family.
It was our name they called, Ma said. Just now, Nolan.
The man looked up from his book.
They called Cohen, he said. Go back and wait your turn, and listen more carefully this time.
Ma's face flushed red.
Come, children.
When we got back to our seats, another family had taken them. Ma wanted to stand there, but a guard made us move along.
Fine seats. Everyone must be seated, he said. We can't have people milling around.
We're not milling. We're standing still, Maureen snapped.
Take those seats over there.
The guard pointed way back in the room.
But here are some closer,
Ma offered. The guard pointed again.
Over there.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.